This week's episode of SmackDown Live started with Paige backstage. She told us that Shane McMahon wouldn't be here tonight because he was thrown directly at one of the announce tables at Greatest Royal Rumble. The new general manager also announced that the match between Shinsuke Nakamura and AJ Styles was going to be no disqualification. Meanwhile, out in the arena, Miz is in the ring and ready for a segment of Miz TV with U.S. champion Jeff Hardy. Before the former Hardy Boy arrived, though, Miz sent a warning to Seth Rollins that he was coming back for his Intercontinental Championship at Backlash. Miz and Hardy bantered back and forth, and Jeff didn't hold back his feelings when the Miz asked whether he was a better Intercontinental Champion than Seth Rollins. In response to this, using all of the power at his disposal, Miz brings out Hardy's Backlash opponent, Randy Orton. His plan to turn the two stars against each other failed when they basically said they were cool with one another and had no problem. Inexplicably, though, Shelton Benjamin's music hits, and he interrupts to say that he's the one who deserves a championship opportunity. Orton attacks Benjamin, Miz attacks Orton, Hardy attacks Miz, leaving Orton and Hardy standing tall at the end. The segment proves that, once again, the Miz is a great way to start a show. It's getting harder to hate this guy. The obvious tag match is underway when we return from commercial. These four guys have been around for a long time, and they can all go and go fast. The speed is impressive, given that the last guy in this match to actually debut in WWE was The Miz in 2006. Shocking no one, Orton and Hardy come up on the winning side after an RKO and a Swanton Bomb, but Orton predictably RKOs Jeff Hardy to end the segment. Is it still out of nowhere when you see it coming a mile away? SmackDown Women's Champion Carmella and the Iconics, who now seem to be running together, cut a promo in the back. The Iconics pick on Renee Young a little bit by trying to imitate her Canadian accent, and then they tell her to get lost and go ride a moose or something. It's very odd and very funny. From there, we get a New Day and Bar promo backstage. New Day make fun of the Bar for being on SmackDown because they had said they were going to be on Raw. Sheamus seems to challenge Big E to a match after he tosses a tray of pancakes in the air, which is the worst thing you can do to Big E these days. Big E accepts the challenge, but Sheamus does a switch, saying that he was talking to Xavier Woods, who then bafflingly responds by threatening to eat Sheamus' soul, which you have to respect, or he'll eat your soul. We then cut to Rusev Day. Lana interrupts Rusev and Aiden English and says she needs to talk to her husband for a moment. She tells him she's worried that there's someone who's holding him back. It doesn't take much to know that that's Aiden English, and it doesn't look good for the rest of Rusev Day. Back in the arena, Big Cass comes out smiling just in time for a commercial break. When we come back, he's just standing in the ring getting booed. I think if they'd just give him something decent to say, he'd probably be able to get himself over, but everything seems so scripted and forced. He's really trying his best, but it's not working out. The promo reinforces that his gimmick is just that he's proud of being tall. Big Cass then challenges Daniel Bryan to come out, although we know he's not able to because he's not medically cleared. And then the promo goes from being borderline passable to an absolute train wreck because a little person version of Bryan comes out. I was so close to giving Cass the benefit of the doubt here. There was so much cringe, so many bad jokes. The crowd is dying, and Cass then predictably kills the little person. You know, because Big Cass is tall. When we come back from the commercial break that couldn't arrive fast enough, Renee Young is in the ring, introducing AJ Styles. She asks him about the no disqualification match announcement, and Styles is just tired of the low blows. Renee tells AJ that Nakamura has demanded an apology for his behavior at the Greatest Royal Rumble. AJ calls him a coward. He says he's going to destroy and torture Shinsuke. The last person you'd expect to see in this moment? Samoa Joe. But he shows up. He tells AJ he should be worried about Joe's match against Roman Reigns, for some reason. And he says that he's coming for AJ in the WWE Championship. And then, of course, Nakamura's music hits. Joe, who's standing on the ramp, gets ready for a fight as he's standing on the stage closest to where Nakamura would come. Nakamura then low blows Styles in the ring and taunts him while he's down. Where's the club in this situation? Who knows? Why don't factions matter anymore? Who knows? Backstage, Becky Lynch is beating herself up in the dressing room over what happened last week, but Asuka and Charlotte cheer her up as they discuss their match later tonight. The Sheamus Woods match is up next. Woods is really putting it out there. He looks great against the much larger Sheamus. Woods beats Sheamus by playing possum and hopping up at the last moment to roll the Irishman up for the win. It's a fun match, it doesn't last too long, but it really does give you a new respect for Wood. Absolution joins Paige in Paige's office. Turns out Paige has a secret, and that secret is that she's picking one of them for something. They think it's for a title match. Turns out, it's to decide who's fighting Becky Lynch after they really ticked her off during a commercial break. The expected preferential treatment, Paige breaks up Absolution. It's dead, she says. Absolution is dead. Looks like Paige is going to be playing a face GM from here on out. After a quick promo from Andre Cien Almas and Zelina Vega, it was time for the six women tag match that's going to close out the show. The face team looks deadly serious, while the heels are all joking around and laughing and pointing and doing the mean girl shtick that they've been doing. Asuka and Charlotte and Becky dominated early on, but it wasn't long before their opponents started to mount an offense. The match did a great job of matching the polished intensity of Asuka, Becky, and Charlotte with the comparative chaos of the three mean girls. They were really going out of their way in this match to make Charlotte look like a Wonder Woman figure. It really looks like they're getting behind her 100% on SmackDown. The Empress of Tomorrow wins the match with the Asuka lock on Peyton Royce, but really the fact that the Mean Girls team, and especially the Iconics, were able to put on such a good match with these three SmackDown main eventers, that says a lot about where these women are going. And that was it for SmackDown Live, but every week I'm going to try to pick three stars from the show, three people that stood out, three things that happened that stood out, just three events. This week, the third star is Paige. I'm giving this honor to the SmackDown Live general manager because she put Absolution to rest. The faction never really had a chance to start, and it really felt stilted since Paige's injury. She also did it in the coldest way possible, which is great and keeps to Paige's character perfectly. Tonight's second star is going to be Samoa Joe. You gotta give a man credit who can hold down a feud with one guy and at the same time start sowing the seeds of a feud with the next one, and probably mention seven or eight other guys that had nothing to do with anything. Samoa Joe is an absolute star, and they can throw him out anytime they need someone just to talk. Our first star tonight goes to Xavier Woods. You don't get to see him wrestle by himself very often, and I really enjoy when we get to. It's nice to see him step out from behind the trombone, and tonight he gave us a show in his match with Sheamus. If you enjoyed the show you just watched, please hit that subscribe button or hit the bell to get notifications. My name is John, this has been the SmackDown Recap, and we'll see you next week.